Sovereign in the mountain air, sovereign on the ocean floor. With me in the calm, with me in the storm.
Good morning. It's good to be together at Grace Church of Orange. We are a Christ-centered community intent on proclaiming the gospel, making disciples, and sacrificially serving Jesus. That's what we want to be, at least, and it's so good to be together. If you're new this morning, we especially just want to say welcome to you. We are really glad to have you with us and would love to be able to meet you after the service. You could come up to the front to say hello to a pastor or elder up here, or step outside to the Welcome Center. Thanks for being with us if you're new. Just a few announcements for all of us before we begin this morning. First, VBS signups are open. If you have kids, would love to have them with us in June this summer for VBS, and you can sign them up online. You can also sign up to volunteer. This afternoon is our Memorial Weekend barbecue, so please join us at 4 o'clock today if you're able. Lots of delicious smoked meat, games, time to hang out, so hope you're able to join this afternoon. And then last, among other short-term mission teams and individuals that are going out this summer, want to highlight today that there is a team going to Mexico, and you can hear more about what they're doing through their support letter at the Welcome Center. You can also, please just keep them in mind in prayer and give online as well if you'd like to support them financially. With that, let's begin our service by reading from God's Word. If you're able, please stand with me, and we are going to read from Psalm 111, verses 1 through 4. Psalm 111, verses 1 through 4. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. Father, we thank you that you are gracious and merciful, patient with us. Your works are wonderful, and we want to study and delight in them this morning. So please give us grace, and we pray in the name of your Son. Amen.
Church, it's a joy to sing with you this morning as we worship in spirit and in truth. Sing with us, rejoice in the Lord.
Joy in our hearts with praise. We gather in
Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of 1 Corinthians. If you have your Bible, you can turn with me to chapter 2. We're going to be reading chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. James Holt will be preaching from this section in just a few minutes, and we will remain standing together out of honor for the Lord and his perfect, inerrant word. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. And I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Amen. You may be seated. And let's go together to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we want to thank you for the words that we were just singing. You are the God of glory. All majesty is yours. You are the King of kings. And we praise you as the eternal triune God who has graciously worked to draw us to yourself. For those of us who've trusted in Christ, you've given us new life and brought us into fellowship with you. And so, Lord, we praise you and thank you. All of our life flows from you. All of our righteousness comes from Christ. All of our freedom is through the gospel. And so we praise you and thank you this morning. Thank you that you are merciful and gracious toward us. Thank you that you have worked to satisfy all of our needs through the cross. And just like this passage that we just read, where Paul says that he just focused on the cross and the cross alone in his ministry. Lord, we pray that this morning you would reorient our minds and hearts toward the cross, toward the reality of Christ's substitutionary death in our place, towards the hope that we have through his shed blood, towards the glory of the resurrection as well. Lord, we thank you for these things. Thank you that in you alone can we find life. And Lord, we pray this morning that you would satisfy us in your love. Would you fill us with peace and joy and gratefulness as we remember the gospel, as we are realigned with what the universe is really like, including our own sin and your provision of grace for us through Jesus. So, Father, would you work in that way this morning? Thank you that all of our sins have been dealt with once and for all by Christ, and they've been removed from us as far as the east is from the west if we've trusted in him. Lord, we praise you, we worship you. Please open our eyes this morning to see the love of Christ in greater depth and clarity, and would it be transforming for us as well. We want at Grace Church of Orange, as just a part of your body around the world, to be moved towards the image of Christ, to be living in holiness, to be the kind of people that you've called us to be, and we pray for your grace in that you would continue that work this morning. Lord, we want to lift up to you the different summer teams that are kind of leaving from Grace to go different places, and especially this morning, think of Aiden Van Eck as he's leaving this week to go to Papua New Guinea. We pray for a blessing on his trip, that you would guide him and the rest of his team there in terms of their interactions with others, that they'd be a blessing and that they'd also grow. We pray for Aiden that he would be built up towards greater love and insight and maturity and wisdom through the weeks that he's going to spend in Papua New Guinea. On Memorial Day weekend, Lord, we also just want to thank you for the blessings that you've provided for us and this nation to worship you freely. Thank you for those who have given their lives to protect and preserve the blessings and freedoms that we enjoy here by your grace. Lord, we pray that if it's your will, you would continue to allow believers to be influential in different ways in our nation to preserve these things. Pray that you would convert people who are in positions of authority. Pray that your church would wisely and rightly be a witness to the reality of who you are and what your word says in our country. And Lord, we're just grateful again for those who have given their lives to enable us to enjoy these things by your grace. Father, thank you for this morning to be together. We pray that your word would have its intended effect on our hearts. Would you open us to it? Would you humble us before it? Would Jesus Christ receive all honor and glory? And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Stand again if you're able, and and join us as we sing praise to the Lord. Father, who loved us first with an everlasting and covenantal love, you are in heaven, exalted above all things. There is no one like you. There is no Savior but our God. Hallowed be your name. Pray that this church and your church around the world would see you as holy, holy, holy. Would your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Would you give us this day everything we need, even if all we have is enough for today? Forgive us, Lord. Have mercy on us for our sins this week, even this morning, and teach us how to forgive others from a pure heart and forgive completely, just like you forgive us and remove our sins as far as the east is from the west. Lead us not into temptation. Protect us. Make us holy. Deliver us from evil. For yours forever is the kingdom and the power and the glory. We look forward to dwelling in that place of eternal light, where there will be no sin or suffering or depression or defeat.
but where faith will be turned to sight and doubt will be turned to confidence and our sorrow will be turned to joy forever. Pray until then that we would hear you and trust you as you speak through your word this morning. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, Grace Church. My name is James Holt. I'm one of the associate pastors here. I don't often preach in English. My role more often is preaching in Spanish, and so it's a privilege and a pleasure to be here preaching this morning, continuing in 1 Corinthians. It's actually a really wonderful thing to be a part of our Spanish language ministry here. If you know things about the Latin culture, you know that hospitality is high on their list. And by hospitality, I really mean food. Food and really good food. I learned this as a young man. I was in Philadelphia in a Puerto Rican neighborhood when I was around 18, 19 years old. And it was great doing ministry. It was great going around and discipling kids and high schoolers. And it was really great anytime between 4 o'clock and 9 o'clock in the evening because you were going to have a plate put before you. And you weren't just going to be offered food. You were going to be, it was made sure that you would sit and that you would eat. So I've benefited from that. They've been well taken care of. So then have the privilege of doing that and working with ministry here as well. And there's another thing about, especially here in Southern California, something I love along with that hospitality and that food is spice. I really like adding spice to my food, and so it's perfect, right? You go in and the tacos are there, but then the tacos aren't tacos without the salsa and the spice on top of them. And some people can handle different levels, and I would say I can handle a pretty high level for someone who didn't grow up in a culture that laid on the spice like it. But sometimes you can overdo it, right? Sometimes you can overdo the spice, and you start to miss out on the tacos. You start to miss out on what the food is that's actually before you. And you have to understand there is some cultural learning as you go into settings where people have grown up with spice and putting a lot of spice on their food. If they tell you something is not spicy, you need to take that with a grain of salt. They're not working on the same grocery store scale that you might be working on. When they say there's no spice, it's not the green-topped one that says mild and has maybe one pepper on it. It's not the yellow-topped one that says medium that has two red peppers on the front of the salsa. When they say it's not spicy, they're talking about the red hot one that at the grocery store would have the three peppers on the side of it. And they're just saying it's not spicy to me. And so you can misjudge sometimes. And then be really careful if they tell you something actually is spicy, then just know it's not on the scale. It doesn't fit within your perception of grocery store salsa. It's going to be very, very hot. And so if you overdo it and you start experiencing your tongue is on fire, or maybe your tongue is to the point of being numb, you're not going to enjoy the tacos. You're going to lose the tacos in the spice. Might seem that this has no connection to what we're talking about, but it kept coming to my mind as I'm reading Paul this week, as I'm looking at this passage in chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. I kept thinking, as Paul is talking about proclaiming the gospel, as he's giving himself as an example of proclaiming the gospel, he's trying to tell them, you don't want to lose the message in your lofty speech. You don't want to lose the food in the spice. And Paul is here going to give them an example and call the Corinthians and warn them in some ways and explain the way that he proclaims the gospel is so that people see Christ. He wants to be careful they don't see Paul, that they don't follow him. And he's really frustrated with the Corinthians because they're dividing up into these camps. Oh, I follow Apollos, I follow Peter, I follow Paul. And he's saying, look, you're missing the point. You're missing the power of the cross, the message of Christ. You shouldn't be seeing the speaker. You should be seeing who he's pointing to, the message of the cross. Your eyes need to be drawn to Christ. So we don't want to lose the food and the spice. And we'll go here to 1 Corinthians 2 and read the passage again. Paul says, and I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling. And my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Paul here is going to point them to his own example, and he's kind of continuing on. It's interesting, as Connor started in chapter 1, 18 to 25, the focus was on it, the power of the cross, it, the gospel, the message of Christ. And then as Andrew talked last week, he wanted to give evidence. Paul was laying out his argument, and his first evidence was you. You were not wise. You were not strong. You're not the noble ones. And so Paul's pointing first as his evidence to the you. Look at you. You're evidence of the power of the cross, because God didn't choose what was strong. He chose what was weak. And now he's going to point at himself and include himself as one of the evidences and think about his proclamation of the gospel. Think about his preaching. So he comes and he's going to say a lot about me and I came in my speech. But it's not so that people would then focus on him. Paul preached as he did, and he proclaimed as he did for a reason. As we think through the significance of the message of the cross, that Christ was crucified, you know, it didn't meet the expectations of the hearers in Corinth. It didn't meet the expectations of the Jews or the Greeks. He didn't give signs. He didn't give wisdom. He ended up giving them a stumbling block and giving them folly and foolishness. And the people of the cross as well, you know, they're not the ones who you're going to look at and think they're impressive. And today we're going to look at how that, the power of the cross, how it impacts the message and the messenger. What is proclaimed and those who proclaim it should live it out in the way that they proclaim it. It's important for us as believers to consider these things. One of the commentators described Paul here. He said, God chose a weak agent, Paul, to proclaim to the weak, the church, his weakness, the cross. We could also say God chose a fool to proclaim to the foolish his foolishness, the cross. We'll take the passage today in three parts, and so we'll divide it up. And first we'll look at the proclamation, and that's the message. And then we'll look at the preacher, and that's the messenger. And then we'll look as well at the produce. What is the fruit of this message? What is the fruit of Paul's proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ, of the cross of Christ? And so we're given a contrast here. And Paul, in verses 1, so number 1 here, the proclamation of the cross. We'll first look at the message, the proclamation of the cross. He says, "And I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom." He's pointing out how he came. This is the negative side of things. He didn't come proclaiming to you with lofty speech or wisdom. This was the Corinthian way, lofty speech and wisdom. The sophists, these teachers, they would go around seeking to gain an audience. And so, and their first speech in a city was meant to be them showing off. Like this is what the people wanted. They wanted to see you show off how good you were with your words, how interesting and wise your ideas seemed, how you could handle and give philosophy. You were supposed to show off. They sought to follow people who were impressive. And those impressive people would then gain a following, and they would gain patrons, and people would put them up in nice rooms and then introduce them to all the beautiful people of the city, the noble people, those who had influence. And this was the game in Corinth. They loved it. That's what they wanted. Paul rejects this. He's not going to put on a show and impress them with his words. He's not looking for a following. And so he's frustrated that the Corinthians are dividing up between these different teachers. Paul doesn't want them to follow teachers. And he says it here in verse 2, "For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." He wanted them to know Jesus. He didn't just want them to follow him as a speaker. So he proclaimed Jesus, and the way he did this, the way he proclaimed Jesus, reflected what he was seeking. He wasn't seeking followers and fans. He was seeking faith, that they would be people of faith. This message that he committed himself to didn't appeal to them as natural men. They weren't going to receive it as natural men. It wasn't going to impress them and convince them. It wasn't going to satisfy their love of wisdom, their philosophy. The cross was not a golden symbol of life and luxury. It was a call to be crucified. It was folly. It was foolishness. It was an offense. It was a stumbling block. He wasn't going to spice it up. He wasn't going to dumb it down. He wanted to proclaim Christ crucified. This word proclaim, it's the idea of being sent with a message. You're with a message is the two words that are combined here. And so you're sent to herald and to announce broadly. And Paul does this, not as a show, but to announce Christ and draw attention to him, the one who sent him. This idea of knowing nothing doesn't mean that Paul only spoke the same thing over and over again as well. Jesus and the cross, what it does point to is that Jesus and the cross is central to all of his teaching. It is the foundation of the whole faith. If you don't have it, you have nothing. Your faith is emptied. If it's emptied of the cross, then it's void. It's null. It's not faith at all. When Paul's talking in this way and not using lofty speech and knowing nothing but the cross, he's not unaware of his audience. He's not considering the people that he's speaking to. He was very aware of them. And because he was aware of them, that's why he rejected lofty speech. He didn't want them to be satisfied in the place that they were at so that they would stay in that place without faith. And there are lots of calls today to contextualize the gospel. And that's the idea of making it respond to people's needs and wants so that we can preach to them. People do this in lots of strange ways. I'm reading the Bible as a feminist or reading the Bible as those who are poor and oppressed or reading with liberation in mind. The Bible's not meant to be read by our own philosophy and by our own wisdom. It can't be known by the wisdom of men. It can't be known by natural wisdom. And then chapter 2 of Corinthians is going to go on to talk about this, that it has to be revealed by the Spirit. The rich and the poor need the cross. People from every nation and tribe and tongue need Christ on the cross. They need a Savior, and they need to submit to him. They need to call him Lord. D.A. Carson writes that when the pressure to contextualize the gospel jeopardizes the message of the cross by inflating human egos, the cultural pressures must be ignored. Paul doesn't condemn all contextualizing. He doesn't condemn recognizing who your audience is. But Paul seeks to set an example and warn those who are tempted by pride to think their cleverness will win people to the gospel. Their ability to know the people they're preaching to is what's going to somehow unlock belief. In some ways, cleverness might win people to follow, but this might be at the expense of the gospel. They might be won over to someone who's clever, someone who's funny, to a message that they want to hear. We're confronted by what Denny says, and he says, no man can give the impression that he himself is clever and that Christ is mighty to save. Paul's not against speaking well, oratory skill. He's not against good preaching, interesting and captivating preaching. This is not Paul being a poor communicator and trying to have an excuse. Paul reasoned and explained. He proved with persuasion. We see this in other places. If you look at Acts 17, Paul as was his custom, it says in verse 2, Acts 17, on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving it, that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, saying, "This Jesus who I proclaim to you is the Christ." So Paul wasn't afraid of reason and explanation and persuasion. But notice, even here in these two verses in Acts, he's pointing to Christ on the cross. Christ suffering, his persuasion and his powers of oratory skill aren't meant so that he would be impressed, so that people would be one to him. They're meant so that people would be focused on Christ, that they would look to him. Paul was not going to distract from the message. He wasn't going to do pomp and circumstance that might create a following of Paul and not faith in Christ. Paul considered his audience, and we see Paul preach differently in different places. We even see him walk through the city of Athens, and later on in chapter 17 of Acts, he walks through the city of Athens, and then he starts preaching, and he's in the middle of the Areopagus, and he says in verse 22, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you were very religious, for as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you." Here we find him proclaiming again. We find him announcing. We find him bringing the message again. He sees them and he meets them, but not feeding what they desire and where they desire to remain in worldly wisdom or high position or with lots of interesting and new things. Paul meets them with the message of the cross. Because Paul has faith in the message of the cross, that it is the power of God, that it is going to be what draws people to Christ. He knows his audience, and he calls them to repent. Acts 17, 30 and 32 is where he says, "But now he commands all people everywhere to repent." Paul calls people to follow Christ, to repent. He can't leave them where they're at. He can't just make them comfortable and where they're at. And here we find Paul in 17:31 talking about things, and Paul's not, he's about to give the showstopper here in Athens when he talks about the fact that the one that was appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. And so Paul gives this speech about the resurrection of Christ, and then he gets his response. And what's his response in Acts 17, 32? "Now, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. But others said, 'We will hear you again about this.' So Paul went out from their midst, but some men joined him and believed." So some mocked and some believed. The same message. They heard it and they reacted to it. They had two choices in reaction. They could believe or they could not believe. Paul was a good communicator. And in Corinth, he decided lofty speech, the means that they desire, presenting some sort of worldly wisdom, could get me a following, but it's going to get in the way of the message of the cross. But Paul didn't perform for the sake of the crowd. Instead, it was for the sake of the cross, of the gospel. If something such as eloquence or rhetoric or flowery speech would distract from the cross, he didn't want to cross that line. One of my professors, speaking about preaching in seminary, was talking about one day where he had been preaching, and then he got a compliment at the end of his sermon. And the compliment was, "I love your stories." And that could seem like a compliment, but he took it as a slap in the face. "I love your stories." And his next question would be, "Well, what did the story try and illustrate, or what did it try and point to? Do you remember the actual message, or did it take away from? Did it put me in the place of the hero, when the hero in the message must be Christ? Not a Christ of our own making, one who leaves us be, one who scratches our itch or our curiosity, nor is he a simple novelty, something new and interesting. but a Christ who calls us to repent and follow him. A Christ who calls us to know the cross. As Paul talks about knowing the cross, it's the experience of him taking up the cross and following Christ. That's what he's calling people to. Galatians 6:14 says, "But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." We don't match the means of the world or meet the expectations of the world at the expense of the cross. Proclamation must focus attention on the one who we proclaim and not ourselves. This has to do with our life, with our preaching. We want to live out the cross. That we could say, as Paul did, "I've been crucified," in Galatians 2:20, "I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." It's a call to repent, to take up your cross. And we don't want to be deceived, even as we talked last week about pride. We don't want to be deceived in thinking that our pride won't work its way into our message, our thinking about the message, our confidence, that it won't seek to nullify and empty the cross. And so we consider the proclamation of the cross. It must be done to focus attention on Christ. And we have to be careful as speakers that we do that. As believers, that when we proclaim it, we're proclaiming it so that people would be called to that. That they would be called to repent and believe. The next consideration is the preacher of the cross. In 1 Corinthians 2, 3, and 4, it says, "And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power." The message must be the cross, and the messenger, the preacher, must be impacted by the cross. He has to take up his cross. Paul, as the preacher, was impacted by the power of the cross, and in his preaching and his person, it was evident that it was God's power at work. It wasn't Paul's cleverness, Paul's might, Paul's wisdom. It was evident that it was God's power at work. Paul describes himself in a humble state in verse 3, in weakness, fear, and much trembling. Paul loves to talk about his weakness in Corinth. This is a place where they prize strength and ability. And Paul in Corinth, in 1 Corinthians and in 2 Corinthians, talks all the time about his weakness. And he pointed out that you, as he talked to the Corinthians, "You are the weak and the low and the despised." And then Paul enters into that as well. "And I as well, I weak, came in weakness." Weakness was also the very accusation he faced from false apostles and teachers in Corinth. They said that he, Paul, was of no account, that he was weak. Paul would say it's good that he's weak, because that points more to Christ's power, just as his message pointed to Christ. His weakness, it pointed to Christ. Then he adds fear and trembling here as well to describe himself. And this is a phrase he uses to describe the way we obey, with fear and much trembling, right? In Philippians 2:12, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." Obedience is this. It's demonstrated in fear and trembling when we recognize who God is. And Paul recognized who God is. He lived with knowing the fear of the Lord, as it says in 2 Corinthians 5:11. "Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others." When he was proclaiming and persuading and explaining and reasoning, it was with that fear of the Lord deep in his soul. He knew the power of the cross. He knew the God he served. And he fears the Lord. It's not to say that Paul didn't fear men as well. Paul was afraid for his life in Corinth. In Acts 18, he was opposed by the Jews in the city and reviled. And at one point, What the Lord does is he gives him a vision. And what he has to tell Paul in this vision, he says in Acts 18, 9 and 10, "Do not be afraid, but go on speaking. And do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one will attack you to harm you. For I have many in this city who are my people." And Paul, he had this vision in Corinth and was encouraged not to be afraid. I mean, think of all the other times. Paul spoke, and he was attacked, and he was harmed, and he was stoned. Paul had a deep fear of the Lord that helped counter his fear of men, and it affected the message that he preached, and it affected him as the messenger, to the point where people could see that he might not be of any count, but his message has power. His message has the Spirit. Paul wasn't impressive. My speech, in verse 4, my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. It's important to look into what is this? What is the Spirit and the power, right? This is what we want. We want to know that as we're proclaiming, that the messenger and the message is a demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Some take this to be signs and wonders and miracles, which we know Paul does those things. Paul did miracles. God used signs and wonders to attest to the message of the apostles, that they were his messengers, and we see that in Hebrews 2, verse 4. But does this context use power as a display of miraculous gifts? Let's look at what Paul says in chapter 1, verse 18. So if you flip back a page, it says, "For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." What's the power of God? Paul equates it with the word of the cross, the message of the cross, Christ on the cross. The power of God is the message. Romans 1:16 as well. He says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, the good news about Christ, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." Paul's demonstration of the Spirit and of power is the transforming effect of the gospel, the message of the cross, the message that miraculously brings life through the Spirit. It makes dead people alive. That's the miracle of the message of the cross. That's the power of the Spirit and of God in the message of the cross. It is a miracle. It makes dead hearts, unbelievers, into believers. Those who reject Christ into those who were enemies but now are called children of God. And the Spirit proves it through conviction and conversion. Paul was not just talk. Paul's message wasn't just talk. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Another evidence that this is what he's talking about is in verses 23 and 24 of chapter 1. So just moving down there, "But we preach Christ crucified." We preach Christ crucified, "a stumbling block to the Jews and folly to Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God." Another reason to not think that he's talking about miraculous signs and wonders in this is to look at 1 Corinthians 1, verse 22. What were they wanting? For the Jews demanded signs and the Greeks sought wisdom. And Paul didn't come giving them lofty speech and wisdom, nor did Paul come giving them signs and wonders. Paul came, what does it say? He came, "We preach Christ crucified," there in verse 23. "A stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But again, to those who are called, both Jews and Gentiles, Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God." Paul's not giving them signs or wisdom as they want. And I'm not negating that God's power and God's ability to do miracles even today. The Lord does as he pleases. And Paul had done them. And it's interesting to note, if you flip over to Acts 18, it's going through Paul's history, and Paul was in Corinth. And what does it say about his time in Corinth? nothing about any miracles going on. And then you walk down the passage and he goes to another city and then he ends up in Athens and Paul is in Athens and he's like sneezing on a cloth and sending it out to people and they're being healed. Like it's interesting. And so why not that in Corinth? Why not? He could have done it. He didn't want to distract from the message of the cross. And he goes to Athens in this place where magic and they're famous for their magic books and their practices and their fear of the spirits and other things. And then he does do miracles. And what does that do? Well, we know by Paul's testimony that what he's doing and what he did before them was to point to the cross. And so people there in Athens weren't amazed by his miraculous signs and wonders. They were drawn to the cross by them. And people in Corinth would have been drawn to Paul by them. And he considers his audience because he wants to point to Christ. Paul's not concerned with getting a following or impressing people. And in Corinth, signs and wonders would have gotten him a crowd at the expense of the cross. The power of God given by the Spirit of God is demonstrated in his belief and the faith of the people. The preacher and the proclamation both are pointing to Christ, pointing to the power of the gospel, the power of the cross. Those who received him because of their belief in the cross. And so we come down to our final consideration this morning, and that's the produce of the cross. First Corinthians 2, verse 5 says, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Why does he preach simply and present himself in weakness, fear, and trembling? It's so that people follow Christ as they see Paul following Christ. With faith that rests not in Paul and Paul's ability to speak, Paul's wisdom, but in the power of God. And we've already answered, what is the power of God? It's the message of the cross. Your faith needs to rest in the message of the cross. Christ crucified. And we seek to have produce, right? And fruit. So you plant trees because you want to eat the pomelos. You want to eat the oranges, the avocados, the dragon fruit. And the seed that you put in the ground, if you forget what it is, later on you're going to see because of the fruit that's produced. As we share the gospel, we're not seeking for people to come thinking that worldly wisdom has drawn them to Christ. We're seeking that they would know Christ and have faith. And the produce would be that they have faith in Christ, in the power of God. Paul did it with fear and trembling and weakness, and the fruit demonstrated it was the power of God at work. The faith of the Corinthians demonstrated that it was the power of God at work and not Paul's cleverness in his method or his message. We get it twisted sometimes. Right? We have all these business models that seek to produce more, that want to increase production, that want to increase followers, right? This is the American way. And of course we've applied it to the church, and there's church growth models that look to tweak things. And the danger is, though, that we empty the cross, we nullify the message and the power and get people to come and follow us and be present and give and do all sorts of other things, but not know Christ. Paul in Corinth gave a simple message, the message of the cross, so that people would know Christ. And I think this challenges some things in the evangelical world today. Challenges some things in us. You know, it challenges certain movements, such as like the seeker-sensitive church movement. You know, you want to make church, it needs to be a place that's friendly for outsiders and unbelievers. That's kind of the goal of the seeker-sensitive movement. And it's good to be aware of visitors in the church. But the church is meant for those who believe. And if there are those, as there may be this morning, that have not believed, that don't know Christ, our goal isn't just to make them feel comfortable, isn't just to make them happy with the preaching and the community. It's to call them to belief. It's to call them to submit to the authority of God, our Creator, to know Christ, our Savior, that He is the answer, that sin is a problem that we can't solve, but we have a Savior who did. And He lovingly went to the cross, and He demonstrated His power in conquering sin and paying the price for us. And we are to call people to repent. We are to call them to follow Him. Because living your own way, it's like being on a plane that's going down. It doesn't matter if you're in first class. The stewardess isn't going to come around and offer you a drink at that moment if the plane is on its way down. That's no longer a concern. And without Christ, you are under judgment, you are headed to destruction. But there is hope and there is life in Him. And you can't keep walking your own way and have Christ. You can't walk in your own wisdom and have salvation. You have to reject the world. You have to know Christ. You have to repent and turn to Him and submit to Him. And it's not an easy call. And yes, we want people to come and know that they are welcomed, but we failed them. We let them go down if we don't get to the message of the cross, if we don't call them to believe. It's of utmost importance. We're not kind to them. We're not loving to them if we don't give them the cross. And so it is loving. It is kind. And as long with the seeker-sensitive model, which there's good things about, it's good to be welcoming and aware of visitors. We want to be that. It also challenges more close to home, our relational evangelism. And it's not because we shouldn't be relational in our evangelism. Honestly, the church should be the most friendly, the most kind, the most merciful people you meet. And hopefully that is evident in the world as they see us, as they see our love for others, our compassion, our desire to give. But the tendency in relational evangelism can be sometimes a fear to worry about what's going to happen if I do get to the message of the cross. And so we want to be relational, and we should. We want to be kind and compassionate and loving, but we don't want to be afraid that the message of the cross is going to change that relationship and stay away from it. So we have to fight that tendency to say, what if I do get to spiritual things? Are they going to reject me? They might. They might. But it's better to be loved in the truth than to be hated for a lie. We want to be careful. We want to be relational. We should be kind. So we're not beating people down. We're calling them to a gracious and loving Savior. We're calling them to know Christ, to know the hope we have in Him. And so there is a level of discomfort, a level of unease that exists. And there will be those who reject it and don't like us more. Some of you have experienced that. Especially in a culture that praises a lot of things that are very much against God and His design for the world. And so there will be people that reject you. But we can't leave out the cross. We can't just seek to have followers. I'm not against marketing, but if we change what we are offering so that we can be more marketable, then we've emptied the cross. We lose the power. We lose the truth that's there. We can't proclaim anything other than Christ and Him as our hope. So the cross challenges our relational evangelism. Continue in being relational and loving people, but don't fight against that tendency. Fight against it to leave the cross out and have fear that will change the relationship. A doctor is not kind if he leaves the patient in comfort with cancer. The cut has to go deep so that they can save the patient's life. Sin is a cancer we can't solve without the cross. As well, the cross and proclaiming the cross challenges our ego and our pride. Because there's sometimes we feel a weight, and there's a good weight of seeing people who are lost and wanting to share with them. Sometimes we think their salvation is going to depend on us and our ability. It's going to depend on our gospel message. And so we want to wait, or maybe we don't say something because we fear that we're going to botch it, we're going to mess it up. And that's a danger. It's not just a danger that we're going to botch it up. The only way you can botch it up is if you're not clear, if you're not presenting Christ on the cross as the hope of salvation. The way we botch it is we think that we're the ones who are going to save them by clever words, that we're the ones that are going to save them by using a certain method or a certain formula. But believer, if they come to Christ because of your cleverness, if they come to Christ because of a formula that you're following, a prayer that you got them to pray, they haven't come to Christ. They're coming to you. They're trusting your cleverness. They're trusting your formula. So we need to work against a pride that would say, I'm the one who's going to save them, or I'm going to fail. And that humility that really is a result of a pride that would say, I can't do it. I don't know enough. Paul in Antioch, he gave the same message to two different groups of people. And the first rejected him in Acts 13. And the second group of people, he first preached to the Jews, and they rejected him and reviled him. And then he goes on and leaves the synagogue and preaches to the Gentiles, and they receive him. They receive the same message preached twice to two different people. And what does it say in the second half of verse 48 in chapter 13 of Acts? And as many as were appointed to eternal life believed. God is the one who is saving people. In Acts 18:10, it also says, for I am with you, and no one will attack you to harm you, for I have many in this city who are my people. Paul could preach with confidence. He could share the message of the cross with confidence because God was going to save people through it. God has chosen, he has appointed, he has elected, and those who believe are going to come to him. We can't stand in the way of that. Our weak message can't stand in the way of that. But if we're pointing people to something other than Christ, then we empty the cross. We nullify its message. And so we have to fight the temptation to change it, to soften it up or spice it up, to make it more palatable. We can't get unbelievers to follow the cross if they don't believe. They won't believe unless they hear. And faith, as it says in Romans 10:17, faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. And so as we close thinking about some application and thinking about proclaiming the gospel, we have it on our wall. We're intent on proclaiming the gospel. And you might be thinking, well, I'm being called to do this, and I want to do this. And is there like a certain method or model or message or way of doing it that's best? And the best way to do it is the way that you do it. And so the best model, I encourage you, look at lots of different ways to share the gospel. Look at lots of different things and evaluate. Is this pointing to Christ on the cross as the hope of salvation and calling people to repent and believe? Simple is good. And then as you see those things and you know different ones, the one that you use is the best one because you're going to use it. And we want to be doing that. We want to be faithful in doing that. And so we want to be those who share. And so there's not this or that that's going to save people, because it's not the message. I mean, it's not the method or the messenger. It's the message of the cross that will bring salvation. And that way their salvation doesn't rest on your clever ability or your amazing proofs for the existence of God. Because what if someone else comes along and destroys your proof? Then is their faith going to fall? Not if it rests in Christ and the power of the cross. But I would encourage you to learn a bunch of different ways to share the gospel. That way it's in you and you have it. And that way you can respond when there's opportunities. I would also encourage you, the biggest thing is, it's that we do it, but not just that we do it in faith. It has to be done in faith so that their faith rests and relies on the power of God and not us. Paul wasn't always bold, and Paul specifically prayed for boldness. And so as believers, these are three things you can do as well as you think about proclaiming the gospel. Pray as Paul did in Colossians 4. Pray for boldness. Pray that you would be clear. He prays for clarity, and pray for opportunities, for open doors. And so it's not pressure to go out right now and go bust down doors, but it is a call to be intent on proclaiming the gospel. And so we're looking for opportunities. We're praying for boldness because we don't trust our own strength, and we're praying for clarity that we would get out of the way and that they would see Christ. One commentator said, we need to forget about trying to impress the world or attract the world or be acceptable to the world. We must continually yield our lives to the Spirit, being filled with Him and His power. If someone's saved by your cleverness, saved because you got them to make a decision for Christ or pray a prayer, then they're not saved. It's the power of God that saves through faith in Christ. They're saved if they believe, not because you get them to follow a formula or believe a clever argument. Those made alive by the Spirit receive the word of the cross. It becomes, even as Paul calls it, their strength and their wisdom. And so he calls it foolishness, and he calls it weakness. But really, the cross is our strength and our wisdom. That's why we proclaim Christ. Let it be clear that we believe it, that we believe it is the power of the Spirit that saves, and present it with boldness and clarity. May it be evident that it's God's Spirit and His power at work in us as we proclaim the gospel, as we're intent, even as we say, intent on proclaiming the gospel. We can only do that by His Spirit, and His Spirit is the one that's going to save. So don't go out with the burden of thinking that you're going to save people. You're not. But God is, and amazingly so. God is going to draw people to Himself through the message of the cross. So don't go out thinking you can do it in your own strength. Go out in the power of God, with the Spirit of God, presenting the message of the cross. Let's pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you this morning for this presentation of Paul proclaiming it, proclaiming the cross, the message of the cross. Christ crucified, a Savior, saving us from our sins, calling people to believe it. Lord, help us as we do this, provide opportunities, Lord, for us. Provide open doors that we would see and we would recognize. And then give us boldness, Lord, and give us clarity. We pray that it would be evident your Spirit is at work, your power is at work, saving your people. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you're able, would you stand as we close singing 10,000 Reasons? For my heart to find.
bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. And dawn that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, now worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like that.
Closing this morning, I'm going to call up Aidan Van Eck. He heads out this Wednesday to Papua New Guinea, so we want to pray for him. Also remind you, tonight is our Memorial Day barbecue, so a really great time of fellowship here. And I'm excited for Aidan heading to Papua New Guinea. It's a place I got to go when I was about 18 years old, and I remember the impact of learning and the missions and the opportunities there that will have a produce in his life that we look forward to seeing. So let's pray for him as he goes out. Lord, thank you for Aidan. Thank you for this opportunity. Lord, thank you for drawing his heart to have a desire to be involved in missions, to know more. Lord, to see how you might guide and lead, not for the glory of Aidan, not for the glory of Grace Church, but for the glory of Jesus Christ, that others would know you, that they would know the power of the cross and the resurrection. Lord, I pray that you would give him opportunities, that you would give him boldness, that you would give him clarity, even as he travels on planes and long flights and other places. Lord, we pray your protection over him, but we also especially pray, Lord, that you would allow him opportunities to proclaim the gospel through his life and through his words. Lord, we pray that for us today, that we would go out proclaiming you, proclaiming Christ crucified and risen, a Savior with the power to save. Lord, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sovereign in the mountain air, sovereign on the ocean floor, with me in the calm, with me in the calm.